Homework number three is an SRS, which is a software requirement specification. And this is going to be our introduction into an SRS document. We're actually going to be building upon this document for the remaining homework assignments. Homework number three, we're only going to complete the first four sections. So I wanted to give you a little bit more information, a little bit more detail about what is going to be contained or what my expectations are for this SRS document. If you look at the first page, it says at the bottom, delete this page before submitting. This page actually contains some interesting information about the evolution of the SRS, the requirements, about its place as a standard in the software industry. So I would encourage you to read through it, but make sure that you delete it before you submit it for the first time. So the next page in the document contains some information about the SRS itself. Under project, obviously you're going to want to put the project name and the version number. This will probably be version 1.0. Also, who it was prepared by and the creation date or the original date of the document that it was created. The next page contains the table of contents and the revision history. The table of contents should include hyperlinks to different sections of the document. Also, you're going to want to make sure that the page numbers are correct and are pointing to the correct section of the document, especially as we add more content for each one of the homework assignments. Now, the section under revision history, the first entry in this is going to be the creation date, and then each time that you make changes to the document, you're going to add another revision date and the reasons for the changes. Now, homework four is not an acceptable reason for a change to a document, but the addition of use cases would be an acceptable reason for a change. So make sure that you give a little bit of information about what the revision is for, and then the version number. If you're going to be changing the version number, indicate that in the revision history. The next section of the document is section one, and it begins with an introduction. This is a brief introduction into the system that's going to be developed. I would recommend one or two brief paragraphs that introduces the business and the problems that it's having and how your proposed system is going to solve these problems. Don't go into too much detail. We'll be adding detail later. This is just a couple of brief paragraphs about the business, its problems, and how your system is planning on solving those problems. The next section, 1.1, this is the purpose and the intended audience. It's the purpose of this document, not the purpose of the project. So who is the document being prepared for and why? Section 1.2 is the project scope. The scope focuses on the limitations of the system in the business area, what it does and what it does not do. So you might say something like, this system will be limited to the reservation functionality of the business only. You don't need to be detailed here. This should be a brief one paragraph summary of the scope, what is and what is not included. So you might say the product will do X, but it won't do Y. Or maybe the product will do X, Y, and Z. Remember, keep it brief. We're going to add detail later. In section 1.3 are the terms, definition, and acronyms. This section is meant to clarify the terms used in the document, terms that might have an ambiguous meaning, acronyms or phrases, catchphrases within the company that people outside of the company may not be familiar with. Remember, this document is for a client, so include any terms in this list that non-technical people may not be familiar with, terms that you are well familiar with but non-technical people may not know, such as servers or cloud storage, or these catchwords that we know, the computer geeks know what they mean, but everybody else is confused about. So also, I'm going to have you alphabetize this list and bold the terms so that the terms stand out from the definition. The last part of section 1.4 are the references. This section lists where you got the information about the system and its features. Did you get them from interviews, discussions, reading their documents? This is not a reference to where you got the prices for the hardware on Amazon or where you got the descriptions of the SRS in Wikipedia. This is specifically a reference for where you got the information about the system that you are proposing. Section number two is an is a overall description of the project. Section 2.1, the product perspective, is one or two brief paragraphs of high-level marketing about the product. Section 2.2, the product features, this is also high-level marketing, a couple of brief paragraphs or a bulleted list of the functionality of the system. Think of what you might see if you were to go into Best Buy's to buy some software or a new game, and you pulled a box off the shelf and you turned to the front of it and it had a paragraph or two about what this new software game is. And you turned the box over and it gave you a bulleted list, a short bulleted list of the things that the new game could do. This is what you're including in section 2.1 and 2.2. High-level marketing sort of information about it. We're going to go into detail in a later section. Section 2.3 identifies the user classes and characteristics. Who is going to be using the system and what is their expected skill level? Break it out if necessary. So there are going to be a number of different users of the system, and it is fully acceptable that each one may have a different skill level. And so you're going to create a list of the user categories and their expected skill level within here. Section 2.4 is the operating environment. How, where, under what conditions is the system going to be used? Is it used outdoors? Is it used indoors? Is it used by multiple users or just a single user? This is the conditions, the environment under which the system is going to be used. 2.5 lists the design and implementation constraints. What kind of constraints are being placed upon the system, or what kind of things do we have to take into consideration? What about the DMV or other third-party insurances that we're going to have to be receiving information from or interacting with? Section 2.6, assumptions and dependencies. Are there dependencies, things that this system depend on, as a matter of course, that are outside of our control? Let's say, for instance, that it has to be up and running for the Christmas season by December 1st, or that there are certain legal requirements that have to be followed. That would go under the assumptions and dependencies. We are going to make the assumption that we can get the system done or this portion of the system done based upon something happening that may be outside of our control. Section number 3, system features. This is where we're going to give a detailed description of the specific functionality of the system from the client's perspective. So we're going to break out each one of the user categories, each one of the user groups, each one of the employee groups, and we are going to define the specific functionality available to that user group based upon their needs for the system. You're going to see that under system features in the SRS, there's an example of what this looks like. I would strongly encourage you to follow this format. Make sure that you include all of the user categories. Break out each one of the employees if they have different functions and features of the system specifically for them. The last section of the document that we're going to be covering in homework 3 are the non-functional requirements. If you remember, we covered the non-functional requirements in chapter 3. On page 113, it listed 4 categories of non-functional requirements: operational, performance, security, and cultural political. You can use these 4 categories of non-functional requirements if you want to, or you can use the categories or the groups for the non-functional requirements as listed on your document called FERPS Plus. FERPS Plus is an acronym for functionality, usability, reliability, performance, supportability, plus miscellaneous items that are not covered in any of the other categories. You can do an internet search on FERPS Plus and it will give you more detailed information on each one of these 6 categories. Or you're more than welcome to use the 4 non-functional categories that are listed in our book, Chapter 3, page 113. Now, we're just covering the first 4 chapters in Homework 3. We'll be adding to it as we move through each one of the additional homework assignments. A couple of things that I might want to comment on is that as you're filling out this document, make sure that you don't use a possessive tone. Don't say things like, I will or we will. say things like the system will. So we're not going to use a possessive tone. And also make sure that you read through the document itself, because there is a lot of rich information under each one of the categories describing the expectations for the information that would be put there. So that's all we're going to be covering for now. Let me know if you have any questions.